Who is Charles Fourier? This person set as the channel's profile picture. That's a wonderful rendition drawn by my wife. Here's an older version. Charles Fourier is a French thinker, born in 1772. Quite ahead of his time in many ways, he is credited for coining the word feminism, and he was an avowed early proponent of women's emancipation, declaring that the extension of women's rights is the basic principle of all social progress. He was also a proponent of gay rights, at a time when this was almost literally unheard of, before even the advent of the term homosexuality. He believed that humans have a legitimate need for a wide range of sexual preferences and also defended deviations from gender norms. Today, he's perhaps most remembered for his influence on Marx and Engels. He was an early socialist thinker, one of the thinkers Marx termed utopian socialists. Such thinkers were named utopian by Marx because rather than analyzing current societal trends and using them as a basis for macro-historical future predictions, such thinkers tried to start by drawing up blueprints for an ideal society, usually on the basis of some principles of morality or justice. Fourier famously drew up such blueprints for utopian communities that he called phalansteries, where work would be assigned to people based on their preferences and abilities, job positions would be rotated to avoid boredom, and accommodations would be arranged for the full actualization of people's needs. For any contemporary socialist, it wouldn't be difficult to find many shortcomings in Fourier's blueprints, which I should mention he didn't actually term socialism. These shortcomings aren't entirely Fourier's fault, though, because he lived in a very early stage of industrial capitalism and couldn't possibly have predicted its development, as well as the full extent of its problems or the solutions it makes possible. Despite this, Fourier was amazingly novel, and already in these early stages, he saw many of capitalism's emerging problems. He saw how capital accumulation creates a vicious cycle, and how, whereas in previous times poverty was caused by scarcity, poverty now paradoxically becomes the result of superabundance itself. He also saw how emancipation cannot be separated from advancements in technology, as well as reorganizations of industrial and domestic life. For these insights, Marx and Engels saw in Fourier a budding dialectician with great potential. But Fourier is the greatest, Engels says, in his conception of the history of society. Like Marx and Engels later would do, Fourier divided the history of society into stages through which it passes, trying to uncover the laws of societal evolution. He believed that we had passed through the stages of savagery, patriarchate, and barbarism, and were currently in the stage of civilization, a term he used very negatively, and which he believed would be surpassed by further social stages, guaranteeism, seriosophy, and harmonism. It wouldn't end there, though. The full list of the stages he identified is dizzying. 32 social periods, which can be halved into the ascending stages and the descending stages, alternatively divided into 4 phases, and each one of the 32 social periods has within it 4 sub-stages, infancy, growth, decline, and decay. Fourier is certainly a strange thinker. He's not notable for the rigor of his thinking, the consistency of his thought, nor certainly its groundedness, but he is notable for his satirical skill, also something Engels praised him for, as well as his highly critical attitude, and most of all, his utopian drive, his strong desire for a different future. Fourier was one of the first in the early modern period to dare to assert that a different world is possible, to look towards it and try to map out what it might look like, a world where the passions have been freed and directed towards socially healthy ends, a world where work is a source of happiness rather than misery, a world where society is organized in a rationally planned and collectively beneficial manner, a world that has 6 moons, where the North Pole is warmer than the Mediterranean and the ocean tastes like lemonade. Yes, those are actually all things that he predicted. For some of these bizarre predictions, he was also later influential to surrealist writers. As I said, he's a strange thinker. Really, I can't think of any other thinker who's simultaneously so influential and in some ways so ahead of his time, while also often being so absurd. Sometimes it's hard to tell if he's joking or not. His predictions weren't just historical and social. He had predictions about nature and the cosmos too, all of which he believed to be related. This is part of why he wasn't talked about that much among later socialists, who found many of his ideas embarrassing. There were Fourierist groups, and they were quite popular in the first half of the 19th century, but these often reduced him to the more conventional parts of his thought. But I guess to be ahead of your time, you kind of have to risk also being absurd. And the criticisms of utopian socialism coming from Marx are definitely on point. The problem with trying to draw out a blueprint for what an ideal society would look like must almost necessarily fail, not just because the world is too complex to make such predictions, but also because our moral and ethical beliefs are a product of the existing society, and if we try to base a utopian society on them, we risk merely reproducing the current one. And there's no shortage of examples of the ways in which Fourier is a product of his society, as utopian as he may be. Okay, now all this is very interesting, but it still doesn't answer why, of all people, I specifically picked this guy to be my avatar. Well, that's because I named my channel Cuck Philosophy, naming it after an insult often thrown at left-wingers, and Charles Fourier has written about cuckoldry. A hierarchy of cuckoldry, to be exact. Now, first, a note. Today, cuckoldry is often used to refer to a fetish, the fantasy of your spouse or significant other cheating on you, and therefore people called cucks today are often meant to be those who enjoy being cheated on, or at least the fantasy of being cheated on. This wasn't the case in Fourier's time. A cuckold wasn't necessarily a fetishist, or someone who fantasizes about infidelity, but rather, any man whose wife had been unfaithful. I say wife rather than significant other in general, because of course at that time you weren't expected to have sex at all outside of marriage. So Fourier, being the obsessive taxonomist that he is, listed 75, yes, 75 types of cucks. In fact, he was also planning to have a parallel list for female cuckolds, coquettes, I guess, but this project was never finished. You might think that the project of listing over 70 types of cucks is strange, but for Fourier, this was certainly not anything out of the ordinary. He was obsessed with taxonomy, with categorizing, with making lists. For him, everything had to be enumerated. The 7 vices of commerce, the 3 kinds of freedom, the 16 causes of despair for working people, the 16 misfortunes of married life, the 8 degrees of love, the 8 sources of annoyance in domestic life, one of which is cuckoldry, and on and on and on. Many of these enumerations were meant to be combined or exhibit patterns. For example, Fourier identified 12 secondary passions, and there are 12 because they correspond to the 12 tones of the standard Western musical scale. Based on these 12 passions, he claimed that there are 810 personality types, defined by which passions predominate in a given person. Therefore, he concluded that the ideal community would have exactly 1,620 people, 2 of each personality type. Some of his enumerations are mind-bogglingly specific. For example, he calculates that in later stages of society, there will be 37 million poets equal to Homer, and 37 million mathematicians equal to Newton. But to return to the list of cucks, each cuckold in the list is given a name and a short description. For example, there's the condemned cuckold, the mystical cuckold, the irate cuckold, and the abandoned cuckold. It seems like a lot of the people on the right who use the word cuck as an insult might be exemplars of number 58, the misanthropic cuckold. The misanthropic cuckold, Fourier says, is a man who discovers the affair, takes a violent dislike to the world, and claims that the century is corrupt and that morals have vanished. He is a semi-madman, pitiful in his moralistic wailing, and he would have done better not to marry. Others might be number 2, the presumptive cuckold. This is a man who dreads his common destiny long before the marriage, who tortures his mind in his efforts to escape it, and suffers misfortune before actually experiencing it. For Fourier, the taxonomy of cuckolds isn't merely an intellectual exercise. He is like a doctor identifying the symptoms of an illness. And if cuckoldry is the symptom, the illness is the institution of marriage, and more widely the historical stage of which it is a part of. Of course, marriage was even more restrictive and repressive back then than it is now, engaged in mostly for economic reasons, as it still often is, and adultery was widespread, especially among the bourgeoisie. And Fourier, from the prevalence of cuckoldry, concluded that there are clearly needs people have that aren't being addressed. Notice that when the right uses the term cuck as an insult, it's a personal attack. More than that, it's the reduction of political issues to a personal moral failing. They take wide societal phenomena like immigration, the decline of nationalism, changing gender norms, and attribute the cause of these things to, well, people being cucks. Fourier does the opposite, taking something often considered to be a personal moral failing and seeing it as a symptom of something bigger. If so many people indeed are cucks, what wider social ill does this point to? Thus, what is often considered a personal issue is transformed into social critique. Now, the hierarchy of cuckolds is published along with the hierarchy of bankruptcy, all the ways in which people fraudulently declare bankruptcy to avoid paying back their debts. Why is this? Why is the list of cuckolds published along with the list of bankruptcies? Well, firstly, both could be categorized under a single word, commerce, as commerce can mean not only commercial trading, but also social intercourse, and in its more archaic meaning, sexual intercourse. But more importantly, these two elements, cuckoldry and bankruptcy, are two parts of one unified critique of civilization. It's a juxtaposition that exposes hypocrisy, which Fourier saw civilization as being absolutely full of, even as one of civilization's defining and unique aspects. Hypocrisy in marriage and hypocrisy in business, a society which overregulates people's love lives while underregulating the economy, a society in which marriage is bankrupt and the economy, well, cucks us. These are two symptoms pointing to two social ills, both of which point to the inadequacy of an entire historical period. Here again we see Fourier as a budding dialectician, a social cross-examiner. When Fourier was writing, he was in many ways ahead of his time, and in some ways he still is. The only way to make Fourier obsolete is to answer his call of radical social transformation. And yet, in the past century, we have stagnated and lost our capacity for collective political imagination. Our social powers have become merely instruments of a now antiquated social order, and that is the most radical sense in which we are cucked. And until we overcome this, really all philosophy will be cuck philosophy. And now I'd like to thank my patron cucks who enjoy giving me their hard-earned money. Apply Quine That Doesn't Work on 37th Call, A Pronounceable Name, Alec Radford, Andre Oliva, Bathild and Daff, Christopher, Clark Fletcher, Connor D, Dancing Vulture, Daniel Zotner, Dinka Pinyon, Son, Evie Rosk, Ian Dent, Edison Hua, Ethan Hastings, Franklin Hirsch, Gary Coulter, George Soros, Greg Boyarko, Gub Gub Col Col, Heraclian, as in Heracles,
Ideologue,
Jean Baudrillard, Leave Me Alone, Juke Slag, Justin Armijo, Jürgen Lips, Capsi, Carl New, Kelly Rankin, M. Lim, Markle Pax, Matt Gold, Matthew Richards, Me Manifest, Mr. Snickers, Nathaniel Lark, Neboy Samonoilovich, Noble Drew Thomas, Polcat, Rachel Ann, Raphael Mercante Angulo, Republic of Chad, Robert Seals, Sarah Sitkin, Sebastian Roll, Syntax 88, Sweet Injections, Sinkion Bresgald, Tendies 123, Terry Schiavo 420, Theodore Sandal Rolfson, Trevor Stevenson, Ukendoka, Vi-Fi, Yimin Chi, Zim, as well as all of these bankrupts. This video was a bit shorter than most of mine are. I hope that didn't disappoint you too much. A lot of things happened that delayed the making of this video, but I'll try to get to making another one as soon as possible. If you become my patron, you get to vote on what the next video will be. I also have good news that many of you might have already heard about. I have a book deal with Repeater Books, meaning that I should have a book published sometime towards the end of next summer. It'll be about Nietzsche and Marx, so we have that to look forward to as well. Thank you.